I'm Charlotte. Welcome to my second doctoral recital. This is a lecture recital, so we'll be starting with 40 minutes of lecture, and then we have 5 minutes of intermission, followed by around 35 to 40 minutes of playing. There's only one piece on the program tonight, which is the Schubert G major sonata. So before we start, I would love to take this opportunity just to thank everyone that made this recital happen. First, I would like to thank Dr. David Brightman, who generously brought his piano all the way from Oberlin, and for Dr. Carol Clark, my supervisor, for making this happen, for professors from the piano area, Professor Lydia Wong, my teacher, Dr. Jamie Parker, and also Dr. Midori Koga, who has been guiding me through all these 4 years. I do have one more recital left, but I would just love to take this opportunity just to thank everyone. And also, most importantly, Andrew Novosky, our piano technician, who take care of all the pianos and make sure this baby is, this baby is ready. Thank you. Okay, so for today's lecture, my topic is about to pedal or not to pedal in Schubert solo piano works. Before we dive into the details, let's just talk about the numbers. So Schubert is really known for his Lieder and also maybe his symphonies, but he actually has a pretty rich piano repertory. There were 11 completed sonatas, different character pieces, and there are also 400 plus dances and variations sprinkled across this whole creative activity. So this is the timeline of his major piano compositions. Earlier we see a lot of sonatas, and then we have 2 years of gap, and then more sonatas, more character pieces as well, and another little gap, and more character pieces, and the 3 last sonatas. So this is basically how it works. And we can see how there are 3 distinctive periods segregated by a little bit of silence in terms of piano composition writing. Now, if we look at his pedal marks, this is really interesting because in his early period, we only see one. But in his middle period, we see a bunch, and almost every single work that was there had a pedal mark. And the same almost is true for the last period as well, although they're a little less. So what's special about these pedal marks? So there are 2 things. First thing, pedal types are really special, and the second thing, dynamics are really interesting as well. So we're gonna start with pedal types. But before we can talk about that, we need to talk about Schubert's piano. And thanks to this amazing contemporary sketcher that we have a sketch of Schubert's bedroom. However, we only have one sketch, and it would be pretty unwise to just rely on that and claim that all Schubert's pianos are like that. So instead of talking about Schubert's piano, I think it would be fair to talk about Schubert's piano preference. And this we do have stuff to back up. So first, Britta Staplin, who is an amazing Schubert scholar, dug out a lot of correspondences, and this is one of them. Schubert had a student who is very rich, and she can buy any of the pianos she wants, so she asked Schubert, hey, like, which one should I be getting? Not a Steinway, but Schubert proposed the Grabflusion and also the Pep. And this is the first time that, remember that name because we'll come back to it. And this second quote is actually from Schubert's sister, who was 4 years older. And this is a quote, the context of it is basically when Schubert was 7 or 8. And you see the boy contracted a warm friendship for a joyous apprentice, a namesake, and a relative. So this is actually Schubert's cousin, and the joiner is actually Graf, who has a piano warehouse. And this piano warehouse, amazingly, was only 15 minutes from where Schubert lived. This sort of personal relationship between Schubert and Graf actually continues all the way through to the end of his life, because after Schubert passed away, or right around that time, Graf actually checked in with Schubert's friends and be like, how is Schubert? Like, is he okay? And obviously the answer is not. So If you were here yesterday, you would have known a little, quite a lot about the graph. I'm going to add on to the discussion that we had from yesterday. So the Graph Piano is an amazing piano because it was acknowledged by the World Exhibition in Europe, like during his time, not only once but twice. And he was also in operation for 38 years. He was one of the last ones to preserve onto this Viennese action, and he actually retired at his prime. So what's special about this piano? One thing that really struck me when I first started playing the forte piano a couple years ago was the four pedals. If you were here yesterday, you would have known that we have the shim action, bassoon, moderate, or damper pedals. We can also have percussion pedal. Now let's just recap on how they work. So for the shift action, it literally shifts the action, and then it hits the string, and that's why it's a little softer because we don't get as many sound out of all the strings. Now the next one, the bassoon pedal, has parchment on the strings, and that's why when the strings was hit by the hammers, there's a buzzing sound. Next one is the moderator, which instead of having parchment over, it has a felt in between the strings and the hammers. So that will be a more muffled sound, or as what Dr. Bergman said yesterday, it will be a little darker. So there is shade in the sound. And we all know about the damper pedal, so we're not gonna go over that. Now Schubert asked for the shift action, moderator, and damper pedals. And this is how it looked like. So, going back to this whole pedal map, if we look for damper pedal marks, there are a bunch of them, which is basically the majority. And this one is the shift action, which is predominantly in the middle period. Sordini, which is the moderator, only happened once. So that's how it looks like. Now, if we put them into the context of dynamics, things get interesting. We see that in the early period, there was only one instance, and it was in piano. In the middle period, we have a bunch of them, and it's piano, pianissimo, triple P, and there are different pedal types. Versus towards the end of his life, there is that refinement. It was only a pianissimo, and it was only the damper pedal that was used. Now, there are two or three things that really boggle me, like after I sort of put all these things together. The first thing is, does that mean that we only use the shift pedal in pianissimo? Also, what about the moderator? And if you have counted, there were only 17 unique pedal indications. Does that mean that we don't use the pedal very often? So these are things that we'll look into together. And before we dive into this, there's one thing that I just wanna put forward to everyone. For today's context, we'll be basing everything on a historical and an instrumental perspective. So when we're talking about a modern instrument, there are definitely things that will be different, and it has to be sort of taken into the context of that instrument. Just thinking about the idea of affordance, knowing how different this instrument is, and how a lot of these treatises are based on this type of instrument. We should really be sort of time traveling and thinking about, this is what we're working with. So I have chosen six different treatises and different scholars and teachers. So the first one from your right is, sorry, from your left is Meekmeyer. He's the teacher of Friedrich Wieck. He's not very well known, but it was there because it was the only German, Austro-German treatise at the end of the 18th century and the beginning of the 19th century. And then we have Adam Steibald, who were both based in Paris, and we also have Kramer, who was based in London. And we have Hummel and Czerny, who were based in Vienna, but they were a little later in terms of time. So Hummel's treatise was written in 1825, which was basically when Schubert was still active in his middle period. And Czerny's treatise isn't written until 1838, so that's a little later. And bear in mind all these sort of different years, like how we're going from the end of the 18th century all the way till the 30s of the 19th century. So let's tackle the questions one by one. Does it mean that we don't use pedals very often? Let's see what they say. So when we get to Hummel's time, it was like everyone used the Denver pedal. So, well, definitely not, like, we're proud of using it. Charlie echoes that modern composers actually use it really often. So how did it start? When it started, everyone was like, pedal is amazing. But as we move towards this side of the screen, we can see how there's that attitude of like, you can actually use your fingers. Why do you use the pedals? And when it started out, it feels like it hasn't been used efficiently. It's adding so much expressivity. It's giving a lot of charm and emotions to the music. And it also takes out the defect of the piano because the attack of this instrument is very quick and also is very sharp and the decay is very quick. So they have also been experimenting with different combinations of pedals. Say they can use the Denver and Celeste or the Denver and Moderator pedal together. They can use the Shift Action and the Denver pedal together or combine the three. And they really love that. Now, as we go to this side of the screen, 1820s, 1830s, it just seems like it's getting to a point where it's very common, it's very popular, and it's almost used all the time because it's indispensable. If you think about Beethoven Opus 53, third movement, if we don't have the pedal, it would have sounded very different. Now, as we get to, say, the 1830s, there is that sense of like, oh, we need to have a more judicious use of pedal. And it's reflected by the distinction between, for these composers, say Bach and Mozart, we're not gonna pedal. For contemporary composers like Beethoven, Moscheles, or Czerny himself, they do use a lot of pedal, quite a lot. However, that being said, there is just that conservatism in the air, and Czerny and Hummel are both sort of more conservative. They see a lot of pedal as useless. Say for this instrument, for Hummel, the shift pedal would have been pretty useless. For Czerny, he does use quite a lot of pedals, but he wouldn't use the bassoon or the percussion pedals. So now, when do we use the Denver pedal? So I think we have a consensus here. If you see the words in bold, it's mostly in singing passages, it's in consonant chords, and it's also mostly in slow movements. They started out using it to highlight softness, and towards the 1830s, it's used in any loud or soft. It is also used to show the change of volume or change of directions. This is an interesting quote because it says, a great crescendo is like a rising sun. It's almost like it opens up, and we start without the damper, so we don't put the pedal down. And there was also a lid, so sort of there is a pedal that can control the lid as well, which isn't on this piano, but it was in a lot of upright pianos. And so you start without the dampers and with the lid closed, and then gradually you put down the damper pedal, and you lift the dampers and open the lid. So there's sort of that like idea of like, okay, we can use this pedal to produce an artificial sort of crescendo. But out of everything, this is the quote that I found the most interesting. So Kramer in 1812 said this, quote, some authors prefer writing ped, P-E-D, when the open pedal is to be used. The open pedal is chiefly used in slow movements, when the same harmony is prolonged. When a change takes place in the harmony, the pedal must be dropped. So when I was looking into all these pedal marks, Schubert actually had two very distinctive damper pedal markings. He wrote pad PED, and he wrote contadel or colpadel. And here are a couple different examples, and as we look at it, we'll talk a little more about that. So let's start with the pad. So this is the first one which everyone sort of knows very well. If we follow what Kramer was saying and actually put down the pedal, this is how it's going to sound.
Thank you.
if I actually change on every single beat or every single bar, then this is how it's gonna sound. It's really interesting because as a modern pianist, we'll be like, we see all these little things changing in the melody. We shouldn't pedal two notes in the melody together, so we should really change the pedal. But here, it works surprisingly pretty well. Now, the second example that we have is also a pad marking, and this time we have the same harmonies throughout. But it's really interesting because we see a bunch of rest in the middle, right here. And we see how Schubert intentionally put the word pad again. So we are basically holding down the pedal, and we're changing and holding down the pedal all the way to the end with all these rests in the middle, even though it's the same harmony. And this is how it'll sound if I follow exactly what Schubert wrote. Now, if I don't follow him and actually show the rest, this is how it'll sound. Different. And our next example is here from the Bowman musical number 4. This one is particularly interesting because we see a constant change of harmonies. Almost every bar we're having a new harmony, and here we're changing quite often. So let's hear it. If we actually put the pedal down throughout the whole thing, how is it actually going to sound? Now, Kramer was saying we should be changing the pedal when the harmony is changing. So let me actually do that. Schubert wrote the word pad, it doesn't necessarily mean, okay, we're gonna put down the pedal till forever. But it's more like he was going for a blurred effect. And that's why it was pretty close to what Kramer said, but not exactly. And this will prove my point a little more. We are looking at Sonata in AD 959. This is the very end of the first movement. We see a bunch of fermatas sort of interspersing between the arpeggios, they're spread between two hands, and we see the pad right there, and we see A major, B flat, A major again, all the way to the end. So if I just put down the pedal all the way throughout, this is how it's gonna sound. Actually works pretty well because there is that blur where the harmony was allowed to sort of disperse, but then there's that like little change of like how we're going from this A major and we have something a little more elevated and go back to what it was. Now if I'm actually changing the pedal, this is how it will sound. Pretty good, but there isn't that coherence of like Now we're growing out of harmony and then it blooms. The last example that we're going to look at is actually from the sonata in G, which you'll hear a little later today. You see how dense it is in terms of harmony and how dense the chords are. The texture is, there are five voices, so it's really pretty crazy. So if we're actually pedaling everything like how we did before, this is not gonna go well. But if we go back to the idea of Schubert is actually just aiming for the blur, but we still wanna be able to hear all the different harmonies, this is how it will sound. Category that Schubert wrote a lot was con-pedal or co-pedal, that means with pedal or with the pedal. And these are examples that we're going to look at right now. So for these following examples, it's really clear that there are a bunch of rests, and they're usually a melody that requires a lot of pedal changes. So the first one is from the first impromptu of the second set, and this is how it sounds if we're not following the co-pedal, but we're just putting down the pedal. Now, if we're actually changing, the other one would be the second movement of the sonata in B-flat is sort of a similar idea, similar texture. You see a melody in thirds and you have hands crossing. Now, the last one is from sonata in D, D850. This is the first movement. This is the only pedal marking that Schubert wrote that was in fortissimo. And it says pedal partly because of the volume. And you see long, prolonged harmonies, but we do kind of need to change if it's so loud. So now that was for the damper pedal. Now what about the shift? So if we go back to this little chart, we see how we had two instances. They're both in the middle period, and this is how they sound like. The first one is from sonata in A minor, D845, and this is the third movement. This is without the shift action. Now if we put it on, we push it further down. It really changes the gradations of dynamics, and it really changes the character as well. It's almost just closed in together. Now the next one that you will see is from one of the Schubert dances. And it's a similar idea. Now with the pedal. Changes the tempo a little too. Now, so how are you going to use the shift action pedal? Is it only for pianissimo? So let's see what they say. So the idea that this pedal is for pianissimo chiefly comes from how it was called. For the French, it was basically called the pianissimo pedal. But they're contradicting themselves because they actually use it in piano, crescendo, diminuendo, and also pianissimo passages. And according to Czerny, a little bit of context, there were five different major dynamics in 1830s in Vienna. Pianissimo would be the gentlest touch, but it's still audible. And for Schubert, though, he wrote a lot of pianissimo and much less for the rest. If we look at the chart where we just counted every single dynamic notation that that Schubert did, in his completed piano sonatas, we see how the bubbles are much, much bigger when it's in the softer dynamics. There is nothing in mezzo piano, but there is so much in piano pianissimo, and we see little bubbles for the triple P. If we look at the numbers, we see that these are basically divided by thirds. The triple P and pianissimo is one third, piano is one third, and then mezzo forte, forte, and the rest of it is another third. So if Czerny is saying pianissimo is the most gentle touch but it's still audible, knowing how Schubert has such abundance in pianissimo or triple P, then that provides a pretty solid ground for actually using different pedals for this. Now, this is what they used the pedals for. It was for a very singing and lasting tone. It produced beautiful contrast. It produced contrast in tone as well, especially for passages that was really rich in melody. It's a very dense texture, then this is where we can use the una corda pedal or the shift action. They don't really require any marks in the London tradition, but for the Viennese, they do indicate that. Early on, it was used really frequently, but towards the 1830s, it's not used that much anymore. You can just do it with your fingers. Now, what about the moderator? We see a similar shift of attitude for the moderator from when it started out to Czerny's time. And obviously, now, Schubert used it just once. He indicated it just once. Does that mean that he only used it just once? But this is how it sounds. And this is, sorry, I'll demonstrate later. But this is the passage where it's from. If you see Sordini and you see the little purple bubbles, that's where it is. So how did they use the moderator? English pianos don't have one. Czerny doesn't really use it, that's fine. But everyone else pretty much did. And a lot of them use it with the damper pedal. So if we have this passage, and we're going to try it with the damper pedal, this is how it's going to sound. I guess the point that I'm trying to make is it is flexible and it really depends on what we're going for, but for parts that are so chromatic, it might not be the best idea, especially on the modern piano. But how do we use the moderator for? It's chiefly used to imitate different instruments, mostly plucked instruments. You can create a continuum of sound and tremolo. They call it a tremendo before. It's also used in combination with other pedals, with the damper pedal, that has a really beautiful effect. And again, that shows you how important this pedal is, because the shift action is pretty useless in people's eyes, but the moderator is very important. Now, how do I indicate the moderator? The French has special marks for every single pedal. For the Viennese, they only write it. But there's another thing. Again, from Kramer, which is really interesting. Dushek, a pianist who was based in London for a while, showed it in the different intensity of dynamics, from quadruple P to triple P. And specifically, in this one instance from his Nada, on your left is the Paris edition, on your right is the London edition. The British pianos, or the English pianos back then, only had two pedals, which is the shift and the damper. And for the Paris, there were four pedals, and one of them is the Celesta, which is similar to the moderator. And with that pedal, this is published roughly at the same time, Dushek actually wrote four piece, and there's also that predadasi, like right there. Now, for Schubert, because we have so much triple P, and knowing how for Viennese composers around the 1820s, 1830s, pianissimo was the most gentle touch. This is really a solid ground for, hey, like, it's time to use the moderator or the shift pedal. This might not look significant when you're just looking at this graph, because we're literally just counting the number of notations right there. But if we take into account how long these triple P's are, then the graph looks a little different. The bubbles right here in the softer side got much, much bigger. And if you count how long they are, say for, this is the first movement, which you'll hear shortly after, 7 bars when we start out. But when we get to the third movement, we have 28 bars. So that's pretty significant. And knowing all these, how are we gonna decide on the use of pedals? So as a quick recap, I would say the damper pedal is used to sustain and connect. It blooms the melody, it opens up. It changes the richness of sound, in other words. For the moderator, it imitates a lot of plucked instruments and sort of blurred things together. It gives a lot of shade, it changes the focus of the sound. So it changes the sharpness, it's gonna make it dull. Sorry, that was a typo. For the shift action, it's gonna change the distance of sounds. And they can be used in any dynamic, but for the moderator and shift actions, mostly in soft dynamics. The damper and shift is also used for dynamic changes. And lastly, they're mostly used in slower movements. Now, if we look at the sound quality and the dynamic level, it's basically talking about the character or the contrast of a piece. If we're looking at the dynamic changes, it shows us the different directions. And lastly, obviously, there are motifs or gestures, say slurs or like different staccatos, and that is just new ones. So given the context and given what everyone has said, I would say for character and contrast, definitely use a pedal, even if it's localized. It can really show the difference quite a lot. And for directions, it's a good time and place to use it too. But for new ones, it's much better if you do it by hand. Now let's look at specific examples. This is gonna be a very brief discussion of it because you'll be hearing it. So for Schubert's Sonata in G major, there are 4 movements. The first movement was fast and it was published as a Fantasia or a Fantasy in the first edition. And then we have slow, slow, fast. It's situated at the end of the middle period. If we look at this chart, it's right there, and that translates to about 75% of soft dynamics from piano to triple P. It's pretty consistent if you look at individual movements. It was only the first movement that had a little more of the louder side, All the pink or the red is like the softer dynamics, and the blue are the louder ones. And according to Czerny, we have five, right? So Schubert was mostly centered on this side of the screen. And it was really great because Czerny also gave us a couple words that might be helpful. So let's get into the examples from each movement. For the first movement, if we're looking at the very beginning, we see pianissimo. According to Czerny, it's like secrecy, mystery, distant echo. It's the most gentle touch, but it's still audible. Now, it's very tempting to just put down the shift action pedal, but especially according to what Czerny said, is when it's very rich in melody, it shows a different contrast. But if we look at the part coming up after, we have triple P. So it wouldn't be the wisest decision to put it down. And if we're looking a little further into the keys, we see how for this part, it's in B minor. But once we get to here, we're already in B major. So knowing how the moderator and the damper pedal, the moderator and the shift action, the moderator is the one that is a little more gloomy, a little darker, or a little more muffled, and the shift action is a little brighter, it's a little more opened up. It might be just sensible to use the shift action when we get to the B major section, and start with the moderator when we get to the triple P. So if we're starting out with a shift action, and you've heard how we can go from two strings and then we can go to one strings. If we start out with two strings, I guess it's still possible and it'll still sound good. I personally don't use the shift action pedal because I can sort of do it with my fingers, but yeah. And for the second theme, we see a lot of low notes and then we have wedges. So that sort of shows us that for the low notes, if we wanted to sing more, you can definitely use the damper pedal just to enhance the singing. And then once you hit the wedges, then time to get it off. Second movement, for this is basically the middle part of it. And we see a lot of different elements here. We see how there's a very turbulent, busy left hand, and we see the right hand just having dialogues. Or having a lot of echoes in terms of thoughts. And then it was mostly in a more gloomy minor until we hit where the yellow and the green comes on. Then we're in B major now. So I would sort of do the same thing, like just bearing in mind with that like contrast between light and shade. Light, yellow part, I'm gonna use the shift action. And then before that, the moderator. Now, this is really interesting because before that we have all those things and now we have a triple P. So what we're planning is like, okay, this sort of works out, but when we get to triple P, whatever we just said, is this still holding true? So we're gonna use the shift action. If we actually put down the moderator here, then it will sort of just muffle it a little. So it's sort of like singing, it's like a quiet, it's a thicker texture too. So that should still sort of work, and that's what I'm gonna do. For the medial intro, we have a similar idea of going from, we have a similar passage where we're going from B minor to B major. And I would sort of do the same thing. However, I would also bear in mind that I need work with my fingers because after the first period, we do have a different sort of figure and we do have a different key coming on. Until we sort of get back into where it started, but it's in a slightly different key. Here we go. So the difference from shade to light, so moderator, and then we have the shift action gradually coming on, adjusting between two strings and one strings. And lastly, for the allegretto, this is after the first rondo, so that's the first episode. We see a very light texture here, just one voice in the right hand, versus we have a bunch of staccato, repeated notes, just giving the rhythm in the left hand. I will be starting out with the shift action pedal, but as you see, it's gonna crescendo. So just like what all those treatises were saying, I'm gonna make use of the shift action pedal to really exemplify, to really exaggerate my crescendo right there. And last but not least, this is after the second rondo. We have this very sweet passage, there's a lot of slurs, we still see the left hand rhythm. So for this part, it's very sweet and it's very light, there's a certain brightness to it. I would definitely not use the moderator. If needed, the shift pedal can be employed here. So thank you for coming, and I hope you had a good time. I hope it was clear. We'll be coming back in 5 minutes for the recital portion. Thanks so much.
this beautiful instrument. There were definitely things that could have been better, but I hope you still get to enjoy the sounds of it, the pedals of it. Thank you again to the piano faculty here, my teacher Jamie Parker, Professor Lydia Wong and Midori, and also is Professor Fuqua's here? I'm not sure, but thank you everyone, and thank you everyone for coming. If you haven't already gotten your snacks, they're right outside on the table as we go out. Thank you so much for coming. Have a good night, everyone. Thank you.